Good evening. On behalf of Electrical and Electronic Engineering Sectional Committee, I would like to welcome all of you for today's public lecture, Digital Terrestrial Television Broadcasting. Let me introduce today's speaker, Engineer Shantilal Nanakkar. Engineer Shantilal Nanakkar is a broadcast and communication engineer with over 35 years of experience in broadcasting and spectrum management in several countries, with responsibility for many facets of broadcasting, including policy development and risk management. Engineer Nanakkar got his bachelor's degree in electrical and electronics engineering from the Manchester University, UK in 1973. Engineer Nanakkar wanted to serve his own country after his graduation, and he started his career at Ceylon Electricity Board in 1974 as an engineer in communication division. Then after that he went back for his master's in communication engineering from Imperial College of UK. After completing his master's, he came back to Sri Lanka and he worked for several organizations including Continental Broadcasting Manufacturing Corporation till he joined Rupawahini, National Rupawahini project in 1979. Engineer Nanakkar contributed as a superintending engineer for the National Television project to making television broadcasting a reality in the country. He took over the operational responsibility as director engineering studios and outside broadcast in 1982. During his period, he started the first live test coverage from Madras in 1982 and did the first live presidential election coverage. From 1982, he worked as a consultant to ITN until he migrated to Australia in 1987. While he was in Australia, he worked as a senior engineer for Australian Broadcasting Authority. He was engaged as an Australian government consultant in spectrum management to 9 South African countries. Also, he was the principal engineer of Digital Transition Division of Australian Communication and Media Authority. Currently, Engineer Nanakkar works as a broadcast engineering consultant. Thank you. This over to you, Engineer Nanakkar.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can everybody hear me? Thank you very much for gathering today, and I'd like to thank the Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka for affording me the opportunity. Let me start this presentation by moving on to say a few words about principles of terrestrial transmission. If you are already aware of it, please bear with me. So I'll basically cover the first principles, the new era of digital, the DVB-T2, implementation and management, in particular, my experience in Australia, and the most important of all is the digital dividend. Okay, here we go. First and foremost thing of a broadcasting engineer is to ensure the quality of the studio picture or the sound be transferred back onto the living rooms of people. So the quality of the content is of paramount importance. Delivery basically is through wireless, which is through ether, and we do not have any control over wireless propagation, although with certain exceptions. And the nature of reception of television, or for that matter FM radio, is from a point to point to an area. Because it is from a point to an area, there is tendency of the signals to be varied in a particular area, In other words, you might receive the signal on one side of the road, but a weaker signal on the other side of the road. So these are the basic norm of terrestrial broadcasting is to transfer pictures or sound faithfully to the living rooms. Oh, it's going back. Right. Okay, so the target for planning a quality service is signal to noise. Now, for example, AM requires 30 decibels, which is about 1,000 times. Analog TV, 26 dB. Digital TV, 20 dB. So as long as we make sure the quality of the signals got a signal level and between signal and noise has a relationship of the signal noise requirement of that particular system, you will produce faithful reproduction. Moving on. So when you go to buy a television or a radio receiver, naturally you would ask two things that you need to be concerned about. One is the sensitivity of the receiver, the other, the selectivity. The sensitivity is the level of signal required for it to faithfully produce a quality picture or the sound. Selectivity is the ability of that channel to faithfully transfer the information without harmful interference. Now, there are issues related to sensitivity, like the grade of service. Now, I'm not sure whether Sri Lanka considers this, but I will touch on that later on. And with analog television, we plan for 50% of the time, 50% of the locations. That's why it's E50-50. Whereas with selectivity, the channel impairments are the issues that you need to be concerned about. The degradation, interference, and harmful interference. What normally happens is that first the channel will degrade. Then if it was degrading further, then there will be interference. Afterwards, if there is more interference, then it would be harmful, then the channel becomes unusable. The International Telecommunications Union describes interference as harmful interference, not degradation or interference. Now, interferers could be either co-channel or adjacent channel. So, basic principles of planning is your selectivity and sensitivity. In other words, your signal to noise ratio and the ability of the channel to transfer information from one source, one point to another. Okay, this is a slide where it shows the carrier to noise level, a certain level is required to faithfully transfer the signal. But due to the presence of man-made noise, the signal level may need to be either higher, would need to be higher, particularly in suburban or urban environment. Now, what we are basically after is the dBu volts per meter at the terminal, receiver terminal. Now, we normally, in our jargon, we talk about field strength, dBu volts per meter. And what really matters is the terminal voltage. The antenna is a defined antenna. It's a standard antenna. That is why if you were to use a better antenna than the defined antenna, you'll get a bit better picture. In 1982, when we started Rupo Haini, I recall the Japanese actually planned the service for 55 dB volts per meter. And this is why, if you might recall, if you can remember, we had masthead amplifiers on our GI pipes to amplify the signal, because the signal level reaching the antenna was not adequate. Now, the adjacent channel and co-channel interference could actually enhance the interference level. Therefore, if a channel is subjected to interference, you may need a higher level of signal. Okay, let's move to the digital era. In my view, with digital television broadcasting, terrestrial television broadcasting, all stakeholders are winners. First, the government. Why? The government would get digital dividend revenue. The broadcasters have more channels and program diversity. Viewers will have a vast choice of television channels. What I didn't mention here is telcos. Telcos would also, telecommunication companies would also benefit from digital terrestrial television broadcasting. Now we move into, by the way, Australia, we actually made 1.36 billion in May 2013 from a sale of 60 megahertz, which was left out because the spectrum was vacant, because digital was spectrum efficient. And we sold 60 megahertz, but we reserved 90 megahertz, 30 megahertz is still unsold. So made 1.3 billion. What system? There are four systems in the world. First, the American system, the American Television Systems Standards Committee, the DMB, the Chinese system, Digital Media Broadcasting, the ISDBT, Integrated Services Digital Broadcasting Terrestrial, that's the Japanese system, and of course the Digital Video Broadcasting. The T2 is the second generation DVB-T. In Australia we deploy DVB-2. By the way, we are now trying to move on to DVB-T2 because it's far more efficient than the DVB-T. Transmission bands, we actually use VHF band 3, UHF band 4 and UHF band 5. And it is essential that you use VHF band 3 because propagation wise, VHF band 3 is able to bend through obstacles as against UHF. And also for the same amount of power, same amount of band, you'll get better coverage. So VHF band 3 is essential for the DVB-T coverage. And I believe, I've seen the Japanese feasibility report, which was produced in August 2014. I did not see any mention of the use of VHF band 3. There's also a misnomer in amongst our some of our engineers that the VHF band 3 ought to be reserved for DAB radio. That's a complete misnomer because in Australia we are using DVB-T, analog TV, and DAB on the same band, as it were, because the interference levels are very much manageable. Okay, let's. I want to talk a little bit about the content and policy development. What is Sri Lanka going to choose? Is it ISDBT or DVB-T2, which is the second generation of the European system? Today, about 70% of the countries use the European system. ISDBT is only used in Latin America, Japan. The ATSC system, the American system, is used in North America, USA, Canada, Mexico, and I think South Korea. So India, our neighbor, is going to be using DVB-2. Therefore, the receiver prices are going to be very much lower, which is going to be beneficial for any country who is going to be deploying DVB-T. The other point that I saw on in the report is the same coverage issue. This is a highly critical point. The Japanese report suggested that we cut off the coverage Sri Lanka cut off the coverage at 55 dB volts per meter. For example, in Australia, our cutoff point was 43. Why? Because there are people who are watching analog TV at very low signal level, and the moment you cut the signal at 55 to duplicate the analog to digital, you will not get the people who are getting lower signals. It will become a political nightmare, because that's difference of 12 dB, mind you, is going to make a vast difference, particularly in rural areas. So this is something that Sri Lanka's got to watch. I also did not notice any practical coverage information in the Japanese report. This is by no means a critical review of the Japanese system as such, but it's my personal view that there are certain things that ought to be in that report, and this information was missing. One broadcast antenna for all broadcasters in the area. In Australia, for example, we actually legislated that access for all broadcast towers be given to all commercial channels, so that signals can emanate from one point, because the signals will be received by the receive antenna wherever they are at the same level of field strength, which is very important. But if you were to have different sites, the antennas would need to be pointed, several antennas may not be needed. So this is a very important point that I noticed, if I may say so, that the Lotus Tower is not going to have VHF band 3 antenna. Channel plans for simulcast period and analog switch off. This is an interim plan, because while the analog channels are there, you have to have a different and the digital plan. So after the analog is switched off, you would need to move to restacking the spectrum. In other words, you move frequencies back to fill in the blanks, because there are going to be blank areas, particularly in VHF band 3 and UHF. The restack planning is the one that would produce bigger digital dividend for the government. The other point that we adopted in Australia is the use of existing TV receive antennas. In other words, because it will be less costly for the consumers if we were to accommodate all digital channels within the bandwidth of the existing TV antennas. And digital is one of the characteristics of digital is single frequency planning. You can have multi frequency planning as well, but single SFN will produce more vacant spectrum. Okay, this is an area that I'm particularly keen on. Service area concept. As you know, that Sri Lanka, we don't have a service area concept. All services are given full coverage in of Sri Lanka, therefore it's very difficult to manage interference. And you know, if you travel in a car in Colombo, you will not be able to discern one service from the other, because there's interference between two services. This can be overcome if we were to introduce a service area concept, and this digital gives you the opportunity. It's a juncture where you can introduce the service area concept, because the new technology is coming into being. The culture of broadcasting, every time that all of you must be aware that when you see the news in our country, all bulletins, they carry scrolling, they break the news bulletin, they sponsored the ads. This has got to stop, in my view, because it can be stopped by introducing several avenues. and we can discuss those avenues at a juncture, at a time that is more fitting. I think it can be done, because that way you would be changing the culture of broadcasting at the time when you are moving from analog to digital. Guidelines for program duration and advertising breaks. In Australia, we have guidelines, 3 minutes, maximum of 3 minutes for half an hour. If any channel was to exceed that, people can complain and we will investigate. The Australian Communications and Media Authority had a separate unit where we investigated the recorded program to determine whether they have they are within the license conditions or otherwise. So that can also be brought in with the new technology. Yearly license fee for broadcasters. We have a system there where we look at the audited accounts of the three commercial broadcasters, and then from the audited accounts we levy a certain percentage fee on a yearly basis for the use of the spectrum. High definition television. If Sri Lanka is going to introduce high definition television along with standard definition, there should be limits imposed. And if there are limits, those must be advertised, because otherwise people would know when the clarity changes from HD to standard definition. The issue there is that there is a tendency of, in Australia for example, tendency of some commercial broadcasts to change the modulation scheme so that they can get extra coverage by changing from HD to SDTV or modulation parameters. Digital would give you the opportunity to introduce niche program channels, 24-hour news channel, teledrama, we call it, I used to call it Andona channel, because from 6:30 to 9:30 it's crying, you know, somebody is crying. So this culture of broadcasting can be addressed as well. We can actually program, put all these teledrama channels onto one bouquet, one program stream, and let them watch teledrama if people want to watch teledrama. Anyway, that's food for thought. That's my view again. Regional programming to be promoted. With DVB-T2, there is a multiple physical layer. You could actually promote regional programming because it can carry several types of signals. I'll touch on that a little later on. DVB-T2 is the second generation European broadcasting system. It's got higher capacity. I mentioned the multiple physical layer pipes. It can transmit both HD, SD, or mobile TV, or all three together. It's spectrum efficient. It's robust. It has much better error correction. It's got LDPC, which stands for low density parity check, and BCH, both Chowdhury and Hockenham coding. Because of this extra coding, it's much more efficient than the DVB-T. For example, in Australia we use DVB-T with 16.9 carrier to noise. We got certain amount of data rate that can be achieved with 8.9 carrier to noise. What that means is your signal coverage need not be that high. For the same power you can get better distance in a different way. As I said, it allows better. Going backwards. Okay, here is a comparison, capacity comparison. Just look at the picture. Concentrate on the green ones. The green ones are the three systems. One is the DVB-T, ISDBT, and DVB-T2. The top one is the DVB-T. for the same carrier to noise, if you can see here, for carrier to noise at 20, DVB-T2 is capable of providing about 40 megabits per second, whereas DVB-T can only provide 30, and ISDB-T lower than that. Just a comparison. There's another comparison where I have compared ISDB-T with DVB-T2. Again, the carrier to noise, for the same data rate, carrier to noise level is lower. And on the second, here, for the higher data rate, you need for the same carrier to noise level for the all three systems, the data rates are as follows. Look, as you can see, the DVB-T 2 has very high data rate. This is another example of, in Germany, they actually did an experiment. For the same level of field strength, you could get higher data rate. Now, the meaning of higher data rate means more channel capacity, more programs for the same amount of power, same amount of capital expenditure. And you can see the DVB-T2 is 88% efficient as compared to DVB-T, whereas if you were to compare the signal strength as against the data rate, carrier to noise, it is 6.2 dB efficient. So as you can clearly see, I am moving towards DVB-T2 as the best candidate for Sri Lanka as well. As I said, Australia is slowly converting to DVB-T2. This is a slide where I'm showing you the signal strength levels of Australian system. This is, by the way, DVB-T system. On the left-hand side are the analog signals levels for band 3, band 4, band 5. The top one is for the rural field strength. The second one is for the suburban. Third one is for the urban. As you can see, the higher signal levels are required as you move into higher radio noise environments. This is the reason why you need higher signal is because to sustain the same carrier to noise level that you require to faithfully produce the picture quality in the house. Transmission and receiver issues. The antenna pattern power, HRP, at transmission site is very critical, because if the horizontal radiation pattern and the vertical radiation patterns differ as compared to the specified parameters, you will have signal strength problems. And the design of the HRP and the VRP in particular is also critical for your null fill and beam tilt. And I'm not sure whether the Lotus Tower is considering these null fill and beam tilt requirements in the context of digital television broadcasting. I think the broadcasters should look into this. As you know, that the COFDM is immune to selective fading across the entire spectral bandwidth. Excuse me. As I said before, the receiver standard can be better or equal to the defined receiver. If it is better, then you will receive a higher signal. Some receiver characteristics, in particular the set-top boxes and the integrated receivers in Australia, differed, because they came from various manufacturers. So we had to set up a separate testing lab to test the quality of the receivers, which is also, I think the ITU roadmap also mentioned that aspect. The cliff effect. Friends, digital is different. It's completely different to analog. It's just like mobile dropouts, what we experience with GSM. The road in front of you might receive a signal, not on the other side. So the people will wonder why, because this must be conveyed to the public in a very effective manner, which we have done in Australia. By the way, everybody, they are all waiting for digital because they have high expectations. Now I go back to that 55 dB figure. If that 55 dB figure is deployed, you will cut off a lot of people. And the digital technology is replacement technology. It's not augmentation. It's not complementary. After digital switch on, there are no analog channels. So therefore, viewers will not have any television. It, as I said before, will become a political issue. This is a good depiction of what will happen with digital. In Australia, we used the cutoff figure was 43, and we normally say that the analog degradation is graceful degradation, but as you can see, the cliff effect, because of the cliff effect, digital falls off, and you will get this button is very sensitive. This is what happens with the digital picture. Good picture, 5% degradation, 20% you start getting blocks, and there's no way that you can watch pictures like that. Okay, the signal noise threshold is not met, cliff effect and pixelation and reasons will occur. And reasons may be low signals at signal strength at a location, impulse noise in locality due to lowering of the signal noise. In Australia, for example, in Perth, we had an issue with masted amplifiers. These are the amplifiers that people use on the analog GI pipes to amplify the signals. And one of the masted amplifiers was re-radiating. And that re-radiated signal became an issue because it was considered as impulse noise, which was puncturing the modulation error ratio, which I will touch base with. And that was dropping the digital signal. So you need to be very careful with impulse noise. And that's mentioned in the channel impairment in the path. HRP and VRP provide, I mentioned, if the patterns are not providing the correct signals, you will have problems at the receive location. And then, there could be issues related to the transmitter itself. So that needs to be looked at. Sorry, my friends, this is very sensitive. Okay, here is a picture of the propagation path. Normally, the Australian Communication Media Authority would define the technical specifications, and the broadcasters would go and implement the technical specifications. Leave aside the propagation path for the time being. We will, as ACMA, Australian Communication Media Authority, would define the standard installation system, and then the set-top boxes are tested and standardized. What we cannot do is, this is the path. Path is beyond our control. So a lot of things would need to be considered when you are looking at the digital signal propagation. As you know, the receivers are planned at 10 meters. Unlike the analog signals, the reliability of the digital signals require very high location probability. This is why instead of 50-50, we plan for 80% for rural, 90% for suburban, 95% for urban. polarization must be consistent, and antenna orientation must be optimized to get the better signal. Ideally, as I said, notional antenna ought to be much better than the theoretical antenna. The practical antenna, if the practical antenna is better than the notional antenna, you will start receiving better signals. Channel planning. Identify the technical assumptions, including the analog coverage and the duplication limit. That is that 55 dB volts per meter level. Modulation scheme need to be legislated, and it's got to be standardized. Channel plans, including temporary channel plans during simulcast, ought to be planned before the final channel plans are put in place. Channel allocation strategy. I mean, has anybody looked into who gets what? What would happen if a person who is occupying a VHF channel is asked to move to a UHF channel? How do you select that person? How, you know, what are the compensation measures that you need to be doing? So that's got to be, those things got to be considered. Do you offer free channels for new parties, or do you sell new channels for newer broadcasters? Restack plan is a must, because you will maximize the digital dividend with the restack planning. If there are any colleagues who work at TRC, I think this is a good slide for you. We in Australia, we actually plan digital terrestrial broadcasting along with digital radio on VHF band 3. The reason why we were able to do that was the packing capacity of digital broadcasting, television broadcasting, is much better than the analog. So therefore, you can pack more spectrum alongside digital television channels. Because of this, you can maximize the digital dividend. Public information and support. Integrated receivers, set-top boxes, can I use the old TV set? These are the questions that you are going to get. You can use set-top boxes provided the TV monitor, TV has audio-video inputs, not otherwise. If it has only the RF channel, you will not be able to use the old TV set. It is rumored that in India, the set-top box for DVB-T2 probably would cost about $40, which is about current rate, about 5,000 rupees, 40 US dollars. Another issue is the one that we encountered. What is HD? What is SD? High definition television versus standard definition television. There are several profiles for high definition television. The 1080p, 1920, 1080i, and 720p. Now, beyond these profiles, it is standard definition. So this got to be explained to the consumers. Otherwise, people will start buying TV sets expecting high definition pictures to be to appear on the screen. I mentioned cliff effect, interference reception of digital signals. We have a system where people can complain that when the digital signals are not being provided properly. So there is a complaint regime, there is a central database. The database is passed on to all broadcasters. The broadcasters appropriately will investigate if it does belong to a particular commercial or a national channel. They will investigate the issue, and there is coordination, interference management. So That's got to be considered in Sri Lanka as well. I mentioned receive antenna selection. This is a very important issue. There could be issues with reception where people will complain that they are not receiving signals. Friends, on channel 12, VHF band 3 channel 12, there is a severe roll off on the extreme band of VHF band 3. Now, if anyone who is picking up a signal on VHF band 3 channel 12, there's going to be a lowest level signal. So I don't think that you have channel 12 analog signals in Sri Lanka, do you? I don't think, not as yet. HD transmission standards ought to be made public. Otherwise, people will start complaining as to why pictures are on standard definition SD quality, not HD. They're going backwards. Okay. Risk. What are the risks? On the transmission side, the HRP and the VRP patterns. Right. It is crucial that you check the patterns and the levels of the levels of all commercial broadcasters as well as national broadcasters' signal must be equal. The tilt. I am in 1988, as I joined ACMA, its predecessor, I was asked to design a tower in Gohill, which is in Sydney, which never got off the ground. But one of the issues that we had was the tower tilt. The reason being, at high wind, when the tower moves, your pattern moves, both the HRP as well as the vertical radiation pattern. So in instances where the signal level is at the threshold, if the vertical radiation pattern was to move, the threshold will be brought down and people will start losing the signal. So it is crucial that the tower tilt at high wind velocity, particularly at Lotus Tower, be looked at. Can Lotus Tower accommodate VHF? I leave that to you. Restack plan after DSO. This is a disturbance to the public. Because when you are restacking, you are changing frequencies. You are changing frequencies and it would disturb the public. But as long as you have informed the public that you are changing frequencies and some receivers are able to automatically tune to new frequencies, you will not have a problem. And we have done it. So our experience shows that there's minimal disturbance to the public. EMR. Has anybody measured the electromagnetic radiation levels at Rupohain or SLBC? Has anybody checked the Lotus Tower projected EMR levels? Now, in Australia, we have a mechanism where we use software to predict the level of electromagnetic radiation, particularly to the public, which can be a very emotional issue. Now, in Sydney, for example, we call it Artarmon Triangle, where there are three broadcasters towers, and people are reluctant to occupy any apartments around those towers because people think that there could be EMR, electromagnetic radiation, which is harmful for the public. So this is imperative that Lotus Tower designers ought to be checking the predicted levels of radiation. Friends, the reception this time with digital, there are three parameters. It's not only the signal strength. In the analog era, there was only the signal strength. This time, it is your bit error rate, and the modulation error ratio. All three has got to be measured. If the MER is lower, and although the signal level is higher, it will fail. The signals will fail, you will have cliff effect. Imported receivers and STBs. the compatibility of this STBs and the input, the integrated receivers needs to be checked. The Japanese feasibility and the ITU report did mention receiver testing. I mentioned the masthead amplifiers and that local disturbance could occur with masthead amplifiers. Ooh. Mitigation and management. I'm suggesting that site access to all broadcasters were given, and parameters must be legislated to reduce the risk or lower the, check the Lotus Tower tilt specifications, which is very important, particularly at high wind. Yeah. EIS needs to be conducted. On the reception side, the power, the HRP and the VRP has got to be verified before you start checking the signals at the receiving location. Mentioned receiver testing, interference management scheme. We have an interference management scheme in place. You know, as I mentioned before, there is a complaint database and where people can complain, and we, the individual broadcasters, will go and check the veracity of the complaint and rectify the issues that have been there. This is why I'm saying that investigation mechanism should involve all broadcasters. Okay, here is my favorite slide. In Australia, we made 90 megahertz spectrum available after the digital switchover. And of the 90, we sold 60 megahertz for $1.3 billion in May 2013. Design the digital channel plan got to be worked along with, got to be planned along with analog for during simulcast. This may not be the final plan, but the final plan will come with the restack. The advantage of the digital dividend is government can sell the spare spectrum. Now, I understand that 1,700 mega spectrum was bought by Dialog for 3.2 billion rupees in 2013. Now, we are talking about beachfront spectrum. Beachfront VHF band 3 spectrum is considered beachfront spectrum because building penetration of VHF band 3 is better, much better than the 1700 megahertz spectrum. So it is imperative that VHF band 3 be allowed to be used for DVB-T. Broadcasters would know it is very costly to convert analog to digital, particularly in studios. There's the transmission cost, there's studio cost, and there's going to be restack cost as well. Other revenue measures. This slide might be a little controversial, but these are my thoughts. If Sri Lanka was to use VHF band 3 for digital, then there is a possibility. I have done some work on the use of the VHF band 3 spectrum for digital. You can use a couple of channels, but some analog channels would need to be shifted. Now, we did that in Hobart in Australia, and very successfully we moved some of the analog channels automatically because the automatic frequency control of the TV receiver was able to move the frequency. So there was no hassle for the public. So if that can be done, and if Sri Lanka was to use DVB-T2, I mentioned 40 to 50 megabits per second, which can accommodate 10 standard definition channels or 2 high definition channels plus additional SD channels. How many people can use VHF band 3? the national coverage, national services like ITN, Rupavahini, perhaps Sirasa, you know, they can all share the VHF band 3 channels. That 7 megahertz, it's got to be 8 megahertz, that's why you need that shift from 7 megahertz, because in Sri Lanka, you use 7 megahertz for VHF band 3, 8 megahertz for UHF. But the shift can be done, that 7 megahertz can be extended to 8 megahertz in VHF band 3. As I said, we did it in Australia. And if you were to do that, you can insert a couple of 2 or 3 national channels on VHF band 3. The moment you did that, your coverage is going to be extensive and your digital dividend is going to be very big, because you have already accommodated national channels. So my suggestion is that after giving the giving the channel for to replace the analog, if there were spare channels, government can sell those spare channels to broadcasters. It is only a suggestion, it is not government policy. Spectrum sharing, that's what I meant by spectrum sharing. License regime for population served. We do that. We bring in the service area concept and say this is the coverage in Colombo. Therefore, the license must be proportional to the population covered. By doing that, you are able to levy a different license fee structure. A penalty regime for breaking advertising guidelines. We had that in place as okay, in summary, DVB-T2, as I said, is efficient, much more efficient than the DVB-T that's deployed in Australia. And you need to consider policy and planning issues that I mentioned earlier, and the implementation and management aspect has got also to be considered, because it is of public interest and risk management practices must be deployed. Thank you very much.
I would like to first and foremost, I would like to thank Engineer Shantilal Nanakkara for being with us today and spending your valuable time and sharing your knowledge with us during your short stay in Sri Lanka in spite of your busy schedules. Thank you very much, Engineer Shantilal Nanakkara. Again, it was a very timely topic, valuable topic, I think, at a point where Sri Lanka is planning to go for this transition. Also, I would like to thank my colleagues in Electrical and Electronic Engineering Sectional Committee, and also the Secretariat of IESL for making this event successful. Finally, I would like to thank all of you for taking your time to participate in this event. Thank you very much. Have a good night.